thought by now they'd fall. But you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. For you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. I know the night won't last. Your word will come to sing your praise again. Oh, Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love, and my heart will sing your praise again. Stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me. Your promise still stands. Great is your You've never failed me.
I've seen you move. You give light, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath. We pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only.
We'll shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour.
Father, we come this morning desperate. And desperation is not a popular word in our culture because it means to some that we are weak. But I pray this morning that we are a church desperate for you. Desperate for your leading, desperate for your guidance, desperate for the Holy Spirit to walk these walls, walk these buildings with us, that you would go before us, that we would not take a step unless it was ordained by you, Lord, that we would lead out of desperation to do what you'd have us to do. Lord, we pray for an awakening, not only in our church, but in the church. Awaken our souls, awaken our hearts. There is work to be done. And we live in a world desperate for a Savior. And so we ask that you would fall in this room, fall on every church, Lord, that there would be a revival, that there would be awakening, that we would understand how desperate our times are. Like no other, But we have a world looking for leadership, a world looking for a Savior, and we know Him. Lord, that we would share it with everybody that we meet. That is our prayer this morning. In Your name we pray. Amen.
In our hearts, Lord, in this nation, awakening. Holy Spirit, we desire awakening. For You and You alone, awake my soul, awake my soul and sing. For the world You love, Your will be done, let Your will be done in me. In Your presence, in Your power, awakening for this moment, in this hour, awakening for You and You alone. Awake my soul, and sing. For the world You love, Your will be done, let Your will be done in me. For You and You alone, awake my soul, awake my soul, and sing. For the world You love, Your will be done in me.
our hearts, Lord, in the nations. Awakening.
Well, if you have your Bibles, I invite you to open them up and get to the book of Revelation in Revelation chapter 3 today. We're going to continue our series through the churches of the Revelation, and today we're going to be focusing in on the church at Sardis. Past couple of weeks, we focused in on the four churches leading up to this point. We've talked about the church at Ephesus and what Jesus might say to a church that was very busy. Then we looked at the church at Smyrna and what Jesus might say to a church that was suffering. And then we talked about the church at Pergamum. The church at Pergamum was a church that was going through some struggles and kind of lost their way and kind of lost their focus and lost the purpose of what they were doing. And then the church at Thyatira. Last week we addressed the fact that this is a church that was tolerating a variety of different things, specifically some teaching by a person that Jesus called Jezebel. Today we're looking at the church at Sardis, and the church at Sardis is a church that Jesus identified as a church that was dying. And so today when we look at this and we try to apply this and work with this in our story, we're going to be looking at what Jesus might say to a church that is dying. And before we read the text, I want to go over a couple of quick things with you. A number of years ago, about 10 years ago, I read a study that said that in the Southern Baptist Convention, there are about 50,000 churches in the Southern Baptist Convention. And in that particular year, 10,000 Southern Baptist churches did not baptize a single person. 10,000. We are a part of that tribe, if you will. So that's kind of our community. In Virginia Baptist life, where we are more connected and more engaged in the Baptist General Association of Virginia, there are 1,400 churches. And in this same year, 300 of our churches didn't baptize a single person. And that's kind of not a real healthy thing. Tom Rainer, who you've heard me mention many times, he's done a variety of different studies, and he seems to have come up with a generally standard and accepted number that in the United States, on any given year, there are about 5,000 churches that don't make it through the year. They close for whatever reason, and they shut their doors, and that's a staggering, staggering number. Last year when I visited Austria, I came back and I shared with you that I was in a place called Steyr, Austria, which is a beautiful, beautiful town in Austria right off the Danube River. And on that Sunday morning, I went into three enormous, glorious, beautiful churches. One church was 1,000 years old, another church is about 800, and a third church is about 500 years old. Absolutely stunning. I can't even tell you the square footage and it was just beautiful. But in all three of those churches, max number of people that I could count was less than 20. I was in a church in that same community. I went to a small Baptist church that, I kid you not, could have fit on this platform here. And it was jam-packed with people who were wanting to talk about doing something in their community. And you kind of scratch your head. You say, what might Jesus be saying to a church that is dying? What might Jesus say to them and help them find life and find encouragement and find a future? I don't think Jesus is interested in churches closing and churches dying, but this is what Jesus had to say to the church at Sardis in chapter 3, starting in verse 1. And to the angel of the church of Sardis write, the words of him who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your works. You have the reputation of being alive, but you're dead. Wake up. Strengthen what remains and is about to die, for I have not found your works complete in the sight of my God. Remember then what you received and heard. Keep it and repent. And if you will not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will know at what hour that I come against you. Yet you still have a few names in Sardis, people who have not soiled their garment, and they will walk with me in white, for they are worthy. The one who conquers will be clothed thus in white garments and will never blot his name out of the book of life. I will confess his name before my Father, before his angels. And he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And so when we look at this image of what Jesus might be saying to a dying church, I want you to think about some of the ramifications in a community or in a city or in an area when churches close. And guys, we know churches close. We've seen them. We drive by them. And that's just the reality. And I want you to think about, for just a second with me, what that looks like. You see, when a church closes, I think a part of the moral compass of that community is shot. I think when a church closes, there's an anchor for families and individuals that gets shattered. I think when a church closes, you lose some support that happens when crises come. I think when churches close, you lose that place that might be a safety net for people dealing with poverty and a variety of different issues. Beyond the fact that when churches close, you lose the gospel witness or the people sharing the story of Jesus or people who are engaged with the Great Commission and the great commandment of loving God and loving one another. And so there's a lot of stuff that takes place when churches close that we need to be thinking about and be careful of that is not something to take lightly. So when Jesus starts speaking to this church and he starts talking to a church that's dying, guys, it's some pretty serious business. There's a map I want you to see of Sardis. As you look at the map of Turkey, you can see that Jesus started this message with Ephesus and Smyrna and Pergamum. Then he's gone to Thyatira and Sardis. Sardis is a town that's in central Turkey. It's an ancient city. It was an old city when this letter was written. The city was about 1,500 years at this point. You have a connection to Sardis that you may or may not recognize. If you put your hands in your pocket and you find a coin, this is where coinage was first introduced, gold and silver coinage. Sardis had the fortune, I guess, to be able to make pure gold coins and pure silver coins, and people from all over the world trusted Sardinians for the ability to do that. Sardis was also a place that if you were going anywhere in Central Asia, all roads led right through Sardis, sort of like Atlanta. If you're going anywhere, you're going through Atlanta. Well, everybody was going to have to go through Sardis if they were going to be traveling in that part of the world. There's not a lot of archaeological remnants of Sardis. There's an image I want you to see that is kind of a reflection of this. If you go to Ephesus, you can see enormous old images of antiquity, but in Sardis, there's just not a whole lot, and you can see the one structure, the remnants on the bottom left, but up on top, do you see the plateau, and you can see a little building on the edge of the plateau. The city of Sardis, they kept their living down there on the valley, but up on top, they fortified that plateau, and that was their temple. And at that temple, that's where they kept their gold. That's where they kept their silver. That's where they kept all the stuff that they had. And that was a fairly secure spot. In fact, you can see in this next slide that it was almost impregnable. The city was overthrown on just two occasions. And both occasions happened at night when Sardinian guards would be manning the ramparts there. And one fella, he let his helmet fall off the ramparts. And when it fell off the ramparts, he scampered down to get it. And an opposing army watched how he did it. And so that evening, that army went back up that same way when he went down to get his helmet. A second time, within a 500-year period, so it didn't happen often, a second time, another army was trying to get to their gold and all their wealth, and they watched that at a specific time, all of the guards went to sleep. And so they just made certain that all the guards were asleep, and they scaled the wall, they overthrew the city, and that was that, got the gold and all the good stuff that went along with that. You need to hear that because we're going to focus in on that in just a moment. The last thing that I think is interesting in the city of Sardis is this final image. Sardis had one of the largest synagogues in the world outside of Palestine. In fact, some would say that it was larger than most of them in Palestine. But you're standing in the courtyard. That image is a person taking a picture in the courtyard of the synagogue in Sardis. Sardis had a lot of Jewish people that lived there. But if you remember in the church at Ephesus, there was a lot of conflict between the Jewish community and the Christian community. There was some struggles there. Doesn't seem to be the case in Sardis. So the church at Sardis, Jesus addresses the church in Sardis and he says, there's not any doctrinal issue, there's not a persecution, there's not opposition. The city is content with the Sardinian church and the church is content with being there. But the reality is Jesus has nothing good to say to the church at Sardis. He's pretty strong. He's pretty firm. And he says there's a few people that haven't soiled their clothing. There's a few people who are doing their thing. But it's kind of tough. And so when Jesus starts speaking to a church that is getting ready to go through a death throe, what does he say? And so the first thing I want you to think about with me is this reality. Is that if we're in the midst of a church that's dying or we're in the midst of a situation in our faith community or we individually are struggling with our faith, one of the things we have to do is simply face reality. We have to face the hard pieces of reality. The scripture reads, to the angel of the church in Sardis write, these are the words of him who hold the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. Jesus is speaking to the angel. That's the pastor of the church at Sardis. Jesus is speaking to the seventh spirit. That's a picture of the Holy Spirit. Jesus is speaking to the seven stars, and that's the leaders in that community of faith. And he goes on and he says, I know your deeds, that you have a reputation for being alive, but you are dead. You are dead. When Jesus is speaking to this church, he's challenging them to face the reality of what's going on. Guys, one of the hard parts of life is to face the reality of what's going on with us. When we go to the doctor, we don't necessarily want the doctor to say you've got cancer, do we? We don't want the doctor to say you've got diabetes. We don't want the doctor to say that you've got whatever the situation might be. But if we're going to deal with whatever's going on, we have to address the reality of what's in front of us. That's just the way it has to be. And when churches go through life and churches go through ministry and churches do whatever churches need to do, we have to face the reality of what is taking place. Friends, if we go to church all the time and you never see a new person, you never see a new face, that's trouble. That's not good. That's really, really kind of bad. When you come to church and you don't see little ones running around and you don't hear babies crying and you don't see messes on the floor and you don't see that kind of stuff, that is really, really not good news. You know, the worst sound that you can hear in a church is not the sound of a teenager texting on the phone or answering a phone call or doing this, that, or the other. It's not the sound of a baby that's crying. It's not the sound of somebody opening candy or answering their cell phone. The worst sound you can ever hear at a church, silence. Nobody's there. Nobody's engaged. That's kind of the worst sound you'll ever hear in a congregation. Sometimes facing reality is me recognizing that we're spending more money on ourselves rather than spending it in the community and making a difference in that capacity. The reality is, as Jesus speaks to the church at Sardis, they have a reputation for being alive, but they're dead. And the reality holds through to us as well in churches today. A church is done a long time before you lock the door and you close it. Or when a long time before you turn off the lights. It's done a long time before that. It's done when you're making strategic decisions to cut out of missions. It's done when you're making strategic decisions to stop outreach. It's done when you're making strategic decisions to not fund children's ministry or youth ministry. It's done when you've made a strategic decision not to welcome and embrace new people who are coming to church. In fact, the Apostle Paul said it this way in the book of Romans, and do this, understanding the present time, the hour has come for you to wake up from your slumber. The night is nearly over. The day is almost here. So let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Friends, we live in a day where it's just hard doing church. It's hard growing a church. It's hard helping churches develop and do the things that we need to do. And the scripture says we need to understand what time we're in. We need to wake up. And if there are changes that need to be made, we need to make some changes. I believe that you can't change the message. You can't change that you're preaching on the Word of God. That you can't change that you're presenting Jesus. You can't change that stuff. But there are some other things that can be changed. I love the fact that we're doing Upwards basketball, and that's a beautiful thing. But wouldn't it be awesome if we were able to do Upwards soccer, or we were able to do something along those lines, and all those who are serving in leadership saying, we can't do it. No, no, you can't. Obviously, you cannot. But you think about what are the other things that God might be presenting to us that are opportunities for us to share. There's a website that you can find. It's called Church Real Estate. You've got an image here of a church that I want you to see. And unfortunately, this website will show you churches all over the United States that are for sale. And there are lots and lots and lots of churches that are for sale all over the United States. With 5,000 churches closing on an annual basis, you can see all kinds of churches. There are churches in the city. There are churches in rural settings. There are churches up north. There are churches in the south. There are churches on the east coast and the west coast. It just seems to be happening all around us when churches live on their past glory, their past growth, their past giving, their past personalities, and you hold on to that and you forget about the reality that our job is something a little bit more than living in the past, but to face the reality of what's going on. There's an image of a church in rural Virginia, or a rural part of the country, that I think reflects that as well. It's not just about the city churches, it's about all of us as we try to address this. Why do we try to avoid reality? How do churches try to avoid reality? Well, we celebrate what happened in the past. We celebrate the building program that we did. We celebrate the budget that was given 10 years ago. We celebrate the fact that we baptized 50 people 10 years ago. We celebrate the fact that we have lots and lots of old members. We celebrate the fact of what we did back when. And we live in the past, and we are not being fresh in what's taking place. I'm getting ready to take a group of people to Israel in a couple of days. And when we go to Israel, we're going to see a very prominent example of this, and that is the Jordan River. The Jordan River is one of the most vibrant and beautiful rivers. It's not really big, but it's kind of a neat place to see and visit. The Jordan River runs with life-giving water through the length of Israel, dividing Israel and Jordan, and it comes to this ginormous hole in the desert we call the Dead Sea. And when the water gets to the Dead Sea, that water stops, and that water doesn't go out anywhere, and that water becomes very, very difficult. You can't drink it. You can't touch it. Literally, if you're to swallow two mouthfuls of that water will kill you. When you get into that water, you don't sink. You float. It's a fascinating place to visit, and it's kind of an interesting thing, but the image that I want you to convey is when we are flowing in life and we're flowing with the Spirit and we're hearing what the Spirit of God says to us and we're moving and we've got life and we've got energy and we've got all the good stuff, that's a beautiful thing. We're helping, we're engaging, we're making changes in this old world of ours. But there comes a time that we might get into a dead sea where there's no water going out, there's no life going out, there's nothing else expanding or expounding out of us. And when that happens, we start dying. And people, churches, church members, we get this place where we want God to touch our lives, where we want to be fed, where we want people to love us, we want people to care for us. And if that's all we've got, we're getting ready to die. We're getting ready to be of no use. So Jesus says, if you want to avoid reality, you've got to get out of the past and get to the future. You've got to face the reality of what's going on. And the second thing Jesus seems to indicate is that you've got to make practical changes. There's got to be some practical changes that take place. Look what this says in verse 2. Wake up. Strengthen what remains and is about to die, for I've not found your deeds complete in the sight of my God. Remember therefore what you've received and heard. Obey it and repent. I don't think Jesus is interested in helping church expedite their death. I think Jesus is interested in helping churches change to grow and prosper. Jesus gives us 5 commands, and when we look at these commands, the very first thing he says is, wake up. He says, wake up. Wake up. It's not over yet. You've got work to do. There's things for you to engage with. You need to get busy. And the second thing he says, you've got to strengthen what remains. Guys, many of you have been with grandparents or parents or loved ones who've had a stroke, or they've been in the hospital for a while, or they've lost their strength, their core strength. And one of the things that happens to them after that happens is they have to go to a rehab facility. Not that they have to have everything fixed, but they've gotten weak. Tom's mom was in the hospital for a week. She's 89 years old. When she was released from the hospital, she went to a rehab. Why? Because her strength is gone. Her strength is gone. Her ability to walk is gone. And there's just some things that happen when you're 89 years old, when you've been laying in a bed for a week. That happens to all kinds of people. When Jesus says this, strengthen what remains, he might be saying you need to strengthen your prayer life. You need to strengthen the way you're loving others. You need to strengthen the way that you're giving of your time and your talent and your treasure. Jesus is saying whatever is left, strengthen that because it's gotten weak. And then he said, remember, hold on to what happened in the past, but you can't live there. You need to remember the change. And then he says, obey. Obey the great command. Obey the great commission. And then he says the one that none of us like to talk about, and that's that piece on repentance. Friends, the reality is there's some changes that need to take place. And I know you're happier when I tell you that somebody else needs to repent rather than you. You know what I'm saying? Because that's always nicer when you're talking to somebody else rather than you. And Jesus says to the church at Sardis, there needs to be a change, and it needs to be pretty serious. How do churches begin to die? What causes churches to start to die? Sometimes we say things like this, we have never done it that way before. We've never done that. We've never changed our music. We've never used that translation. We've never used technology in our worship service. We've never had multiple campuses. Why in the world would we want to buy a second building? We've never done it that way before, and we hold on to the tradition of what's happened in the past, and that's a dangerous place to be. A second thing that sometimes churches say is they say very clearly, we don't want them here. And them can be all kinds of people. It can be people that are different from you ethnically. It can be people that are different from you linguistically. It can be people that are different from you socially. It can be people who are different from you economically, whatever. The reality is sometimes churches say, in whatever means, we don't want them here. And our prejudice kill us, begin to kill us. Sometimes we hear churches say that we're fine, just the way we are. We're fine. And we're very complacent. We're not interested in outreach. We're not interested in ministry. We're not interested in going on mission trips. We're not interested in discipleship. We're not interested in getting our kids engaged in whatever the thing might be. We're not interested in changing our worship. We're not interested in bringing drums or whatever it might have been. We're not interested. We're just complacent. I think the last thing we struggle with, and I think this is probably one that we struggle with more than anything today, is when we start saying, why should I share my faith? I don't need to do that. I don't need to talk to other people about Jesus, and we start struggling in that capacity. There are some other reasons that I think churches begin to die when they start accepting in some behaviors that I think are kind of dangerous. Sometimes churches, they start tolerating people who are bullies and people who are just not very nice, and they get into leadership positions, and I think churches really struggle in that capacity. I think sometimes churches begin to die when a church is politically driven. Whether you're on the right-hand side of the aisle or the left-hand side of the aisle, if whichever political party seems to be your thing, that's not good. It's not good for a church to do that. Church has got to be gospel-centric, period. I think sometimes churches begin to die when we become cause-centric. And guys, there are good causes. But when we're driven by whatever the cause might be, that's trouble. Because not everybody's going to embrace the cause. You've got causes you need to support. I want you to support and I want you to do it. But our churches can't be driven by the causes that are out there. They have to be driven by advancing the Redeemer's kingdom. The third thing that I think Jesus conveys to this church in Sardis is this message that there's hope. The church, Jesus is pretty hard on them. But then he gives this little glimmer and he says this, yet you have a few people in Sardis who've not soiled their clothes. They walk with me. They're dressed in white, for they are worthy. He who overcomes will, like them, be dressed in white, and I will never blot out his name from the book of life. Jesus said that there's a remnant. There's always a remnant. There's always a remnant out there somewhere. And Jesus is conveying to the church at Sardis, there are a few. Build on that. Build with those and do something amazing and do something beautiful. If you've been attending our church very long, you've heard this story. And I'm going to tell you, as long as I'm here, you're going to hear this story at least once a year because this story is just simply so powerful. This next image is of an image of a man that I do not know his name. I wish I did. This old fellow was a young man in 1958 when Fidel Castro came to power in Cuba. And when Castro shut down the churches, this man decided that his church would not be closed. And from 1958 until 1998, when Fidel Castro allowed some freedoms within the church, he would go to his church, and this next slide is his church, and he would make certain that somebody was there. That's not much of a church, but that church is what he had, and he was the only person there for 40-plus years. 40 years! He never quit. And in 1998, when Castro allowed the Pope to come in and he opened the door for religious groups to start coming in, I want you to see this next image. This next image is an image of his church during a night that we were preaching there. It was packed. There were people on the aisles, people outside the aisles, people outside the doors, people everywhere trying to listen. We baptized people on the day before this event took place, and they didn't have a church bus. They had this enormous truck that we piled people in to go to the lagoon to go get baptized. And I wish you could have seen, I wish I'd have taken a better picture of that truck, filling up 40, 50, 60 people in the back of that thing, driving to a lagoon where we baptized people. Because one man refused to give up. He held on to hope. There's another image I want you to see, and you've heard me talk about this one as well. It's our friends in Austria, a very small congregation in Vienna, a congregation numbering less than 20 people, bought this old Viennese ballroom, this ballroom that's over 200 years old, a ballroom that hosted all kinds of parties and gatherings and all types of different things that sat empty from the end of World War II until now. The dark ceiling that you see, that's not paint, that is dust that's about a quarter of an inch thick. When they got a hold of that facility and they had to do all the cleaning and the repair, all of the stuff that was involved with this, I looked at that and I thought, there's no way, no way 20 people can make this happen. And yet this last image is a beautiful image of a group of Iranian and Afghan believers gathering in that same place to worship because a small core group of Austrians thought God could do something amazing. I don't know if you can see this, but some of the benches they're using in the back are fruit crates with wood. Friends, there's hope. And we see things that are struggling, we see things that are hurting, and we see things that are going on. And one of the images we have to recognize is that when we face reality and we make some changes, that God can do things that are just ridiculous. You're sitting back thinking right now, David, that's good for churches, and that's good for the church over there, and that's good for the church over there, and I wish my friends over and had heard this message. But what about my life? What's going on in my story? Because I'm going in a direction that's not healthy and it's not helpful, and I've been making some choices and I've been dealing with some stuff that's just not the best. Well, I think the message of the cross is the same. Face reality. Face the reality of your choices. Face the reality of your decisions. Face the reality of what's going on, and whatever that might be, if you're not happy with it, make a change. Start going in a new direction. Start dealing with something in a new way. Address the way you're choosing, because I believe with everything in me there is hope. And it doesn't mean that God is going to change the circumstance you might be. You may still have cancer. Your marriage may still be on the rocks. Your job still may stink. Your circumstances may never, ever change. But the reality is God can give you peace, and God can give you joy, and God can give you strength, and God can give you purpose, because there is hope in Jesus. Period. There is hope in Jesus. Do you have that? Have you embraced that? Have you got that hope? We're going to close with a quick word of prayer. And after I pray, if you want to come and talk to me, I'm going to be standing right over here on the side. You can come and pray with me. You'll meet me outside in the hallway. You can send me an email. However you need to respond, please don't walk away without the hope that only Jesus can provide. Heavenly Father, in this room, there's a lot of hurt and a lot of heartache. And God, we need your grace and we need your mercy. And Father God, we need your redemption. And I pray, God, that as we reflect on what's going on in our lives, that you would help us, God, to hear your voice that's calling. And Father, I pray that as members of this congregation and people connected to Manassas Baptist Church, that God, we would see that what happened in Sardis, unfortunately, it can happen here. And help us to own our part of the story, whatever our part might be. Father, if we need to wake up, if we need to make some changes, if we need to do whatever it is, God, Father, speak to our hearts that we might hear your voice and we might be the people of grace that you want us to be. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.